Hello and welcome back to the channel. In this video, we will begin a new course, Programming for Engineers, which is designed specifically for mechanical and civil engineering students. The course in general will cover the following areas, fundamentals and essential terminologies and skills, which are theoretical topics and discussions that we're going to go through that I feel that any programmer or anyone who wants to learn programming in general would have to understand first before getting into any kind of coding. Then we will cover C++ and then later on Python. MATLAB and Simulink we will also talk about, but that will be only an introduction and sort of a get to know only. But the primary focus of this course will be on C++ and Python. So in this video, we will talk about the foundation topics, specifically fundamentals. Now, these topics include the following. We will talk about software applications and mechanical engineering, as well as career options or possibilities. Similarly, for civil engineering, what programming or learning programming would do to you if you are a civil or mechanical engineer, and what could that do to your career? Then we'll talk about programming in general and discuss the idea that programming in essence is all about working with data, which leads us to the next point, which is where does this data come from? So that will mean that this is where we're going to talk about the sources of data for any computer program. Then we're going to talk about importance of programming for emerging technologies such as the Internet of Things, Industrial Revolution 4, blockchain, etc. And finally, we will introduce the concept of the Integrated Development Environment, the IDE. And finally, we will introduce the languages that we will be working with this semester. This is just a theoretical introduction, a sort of like a first meeting kind of thing, just to know about the features of these languages and differences. And we might do a little bit of comparison in the end. So let's take a look. So obviously, the first question might come to your mind, you are a mechanical engineering student or a civil engineering student, so why would you need to learn programming? Isn't that for software engineering students? Well, that's true, but the way that the software engineering students, or at least the approach they follow when they're learning software or they're learning programming, it's different from us. I'm also from the mechanical engineering field. So when you are a mechanical engineer and you want to learn programming, your primary reason for doing so is to use it or to implement it in your applications or for mechanical engineering purposes that is related to your field. When software engineering students learn programming, they usually learn it for much more deeper purposes. Of course, for applications as well, but also about how the technology behind programming works, the deeper levels, the technology behind it, etc. But for us, we focus only on using the language directly. So for mechanical engineers, if you learn C++, that would be very powerful for you for hardware interfacing, controller programming, electromechanical systems, automation, robotics. Learning C++ will open the doors for all of these areas. It makes it easier for you to create systems that are electromechanical systems, or to write programs that can control hardware, etc. Python, on the other hand, can be used for applications such as thermodynamics, computational fluid dynamics, numerical analysis, of course, data science nowadays, machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence are all the range. So that's why it's very important for you to grasp Python, or at least have an understanding of it. Of course, Python can also be used for controller programming, hardware interfacing, and so on. MATLAB and Simulink are increasingly being used for, again, for data science, for robotics, and as well as for FEA. Now, this does not mean that, for example, C++ cannot be used for CFD, for example, or C++ is not used for another purpose. Definitely, any language can be used for any of these purposes that you see in front of you. However, some languages have certain features that makes it more preferred, or at least the preferential language for a certain application. So it became known for it. That is why most of the time you in the field you will see that C++ is primarily used for hardware interfacing, whereas Python is usually used for numeric analysis as well as data science. MATLAB and Simulink. MATLAB is kind of different thing than Python and C++. We will come to that in later in this video. But MATLAB is also meant, you know, since the beginning of it, it is all about manipulating numbers and data. So that is why, especially if the data are in structures such as matrices, multidimensional arrays, etc. So this is where MATLAB comes into the most powerful part about MATLAB. Now, if we were now talking about, this is a typo that I forgot to fix yet again. This is essentially civil, not mechanical. So let's fix that right now. So because we already talked about mechanical, so let's now upgrade this. Let's now talk about civil engineers. So basically now if you are, sorry, that was correct one. I think the mistakes in the video, in the typo, in this one is not here, but in the next one. Yeah, so this was, yeah, this is the mistake. So let's go through that again. So civil, okay, now I'm sure that is the correct one. So now that we talked about what applications of mechanical or software or programming in mechanical engineering, right? Then what about career opportunities for mechanical engineers? Let's say, okay, I learned programming and I'm very good in C++ or programming. What would that do for you as a mechanical engineer? A lot can be done. You can become a developer. Essentially now developer, not just a general developer. You can be developer of applications that are specifically meant for your field. Let's say you have come across a problem in your field or for your organization, and you realize that if you wrote a program for it, then it can solve that problem. Then of course the value or your value to the company definitely increases, because now you can develop an application that can solve a problem for the company. Similarly, of course, the application itself could become valuable to you and to the company. You can sell it, or you can, you know, the company can buy it from you, etc. Whatever it is, a lot of the applications that we mentioned, like for example, MATLAB itself was developed by mechanical engineers in the beginning, right? Because they realized the purpose. Things like FEA, finite element analysis applications, or any other applications that was or is for engineering purposes, was developed by engineers in the first place, but who are proficient in programming. Of course, you could become a data scientist, but of course, for applications that are specific to your field. Data science in general is a big and very, very large field, and it encompasses a lot of sectors and a lot of industries and a lot of applications. All around us, really, because data is everywhere all around us. So there's plenty of applications out there and plenty of demand for data scientists. So now if you are a mechanical engineer and you are also a data scientist, so that really covers a lot of increases a lot of value for potential employers. So that makes it really important for you to have that kind of skill. You could, of course, become more advanced into automation, automation engineer, and you can involve in automotive industry, in manufacturing technologies, robotics, automation in general. That could actually be powerful or be possible if you are good in mechanical as well as in programming. And finally, that makes you an all-round engineer. A lot of the times, when young graduates, when they complete their studies and they are not fully proficient in programming, this has become really a great limitation for them to advance further, because they will soon realize that mechanical engineering or mechanics in general, right, does not exist in an individual world on its own. It has definitely to do with other fields, especially with software. So let's move on. Now, what about the civil engineering applications? I'm not a civil engineer myself, but I've got this following information from colleagues. So C++ can be used for compound application calculations and for structural engineering, and of course for repetitive design process steps. Python can be used for prediction of natural hazards such as floods, earthquakes. It can be used for population estimation, like for urban planning and infrastructure such as water management, and of course for soil simulation and modeling of geotechnical engineering fields. MATLAB and Simulink can be used for modeling of infrastructure and greatly reducing construction skills. I have to admit that maybe my background in civil engineering is not exactly 100% or not, because I'm mechanical by design, by training. But if you are more aware, or if you have a lot of more information about what can software do for civil engineering, please do add them in the comments. I would love to hear more about those. But then again, if you are a civil engineering student and you want to add programming to your skills, then this is really something that you would like to consider. Generally speaking, the same benefits that could happen to the mechanical engineers could happen to you as well. You could become a software developer. Perhaps once again, you discovered a repetitive problem that can be done in a C++ or can be solved with a Python program. Then you and your program become valuable. You could become a data scientist specifically for civil engineering application. And of course, you can enhance your quality as a graduate or as an engineer by becoming an all-rounder, by including in programming into your set of skills. So this hopefully answers the question, why should I learn programming? Everyone should learn programming. Now, another reason why you should learn programming, regardless of your field, is to be in touch with emerging technologies. Technology is changing all around us. It's always something new every day, and you would always want to be on track, especially if you are an engineer or an engineering graduate. If you are taking this course, that this is your very first semester, so by the time you graduate, that will be 4 years from now, if everything is on track. By then, I can tell you that the technology would have changed tremendously. So if you want to remain relevant with your degree, right, you definitely want to include programming to your set of skills, because all of the technologies that are evolving and is emerging nowadays, such as the Internet of Things, the fourth industrial revolution, whether or not you believe in it, or the Internet of Everything, IoE, data science, data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, AI, advanced modeling, digital twins, edge computing, the list can go on. Basically, in every one of these fields, programming is the very first requirement. You must have some form of set of skills of understanding how to code in order for you to become ready to. I'm not saying that programming is the only requirement, definitely not, but it is a requirement. So, for example, if you would like to go for machine learning, then aside from programming, then you need to also learn about probability, which I think you will cover in probably year two or year three of your course. So by the time you cover probability, and then if you are proficient with MATLAB and Python, then you're ready for machine learning. Just like that, if you decided not to study programming or ignore it or something like that, then you'll be crippled and you will have to learn the language of the programming before you embark on machine learning or learning machine learning. So that's why I'm saying that learning, that's another reason why anyone would need to learn programming, is because it's part of the emerging technologies and because for you to remain relevant by the time you graduate. Okay, what's next? Now let's talk about this, which is, let's just understand one thing important here. The very purpose of, or the primary purpose of any program, any language of any purpose, is to always, always manipulate data. This is the number one reason, or the number one purpose of any language, any program, really. I mean, if you think about it, and we will see examples in a minute, then you will realize that this is actually true. Once we manipulate the data, what are we going to do with it? Well, this is where sometimes the differences happen. So, for example, let us say you have an adder program. What does that mean? It's a program that adds two values. You give it an input value or input values, such as two numbers, numbers A and B, and it adds them together. That's the program. I know it's a very simple program, but just Just bear with me for a minute. So it manipulates these two values, remember, manipulating data, by simply adding these two numbers together. So let's just agree for now that this manipulation in this particular example is simply A plus B. That's what this program does. And then it adds them together to find the summation, which is in this case C. Okay, so all right, so that was the manipulation part. So what's next? Well, after you have manipulated the value, then you need to display the value, right? The result, is that right? So in this particular program, it's what we call the data delivery. It simply manipulates data, and whatever output you deliver, you process and create it, it simply delivers it, or you know, displays it to the user. So, okay, that's one kind of program. The other kind of program, we're going to call it a controller program. And where, just like the previous example, it also receives data or raw data. Let's just call it, in this particular example, a controller program, based on the input values, then once it receives this data, it processes this data. You know, it does some work with it. And then based on this data, it performs an action. So once again, this kind of programmer or this kind of program, it does a slightly different job than the previous example. In the other program, it performs a task, or it manipulates the data, but then after that, it displays the data or delivers the data to the output, or, you know, delivers the output to the user. Now, the controller program or the actuation program, it does not display anything. It simply does an action. It might display an output data as well, just a sort of a display, but the primary purpose for it is to really do something with the data or because of the data. Let's take another look at this again. So this is the same ADAP program that we discussed earlier. It receives data, it manipulates the data, and then it produces a new set of data, let's call it output, and then it delivers this output to the user. So that's why we call it a data delivery program, because it delivers a data or output data to the user. On the other hand, we have what is called a controller program, an actuation program, or an action program. These are all mean the same thing. Once again, you receive input data, you manipulate the data, and then based on the result of this manipulation, you do some form of an action. You open a door, you close a door, you switch on a light, you do something, or perhaps you call another program. That in itself is another form of actuation. Maybe that other program will do something else. But for now, let's just say that it performs an action. Whether it's a mechanism, an actuation mechanism, or it calls something else. But let's just call the differentiate between these two types of programs. This is basically display or deliver the output to the user, show the output. But this one, essentially, it's all about action. Now, the only difference between these two types of programs is that the difference is what do they do with the data? That's it. But if you look at this part of the program, both sides of the program, right, you will see that it's essentially the same thing. You receive data, okay, and then you process the data or you manipulate the data. Okay, fantastic. Then after that, it depends on what happens next. If all what we need is just to see the output data, okay, that's it. But if you want to do some form of action, then here we are. So that's the difference between them. But if you think about it, regardless of the type of the program, it's all about working with the data. Any kind of program will always involve working with data. And so that's why, regardless of whatever program you're ever going to make eventually or write, you realize that it's always about input information, processing that information, and then doing something with that information. Okay, that's right. Which brings us to the next question, which is, okay, if this is all about data, so where does data come from? It's a very logical question. So obviously, data comes from a number of sources. Well, it's possible that you yourself define the data yourself. One of the earlier skills that you learn about when you're writing program is how to declare variables, or how to define a new data. So this could very well be something that you have declared yourself. Wait a minute. So you said receiving input. Yeah, that's true. That's also true. But we will get to that in a minute. How do you? What do you mean by declaring data? But and sometimes we declare data just to initiate it. But then after that, the data is changed or updated. We'll come to that when we do hands-on coding. Sometimes the data could be coming from the user, right? The user typed or keyed in some values or provided you with some information. So once we take that user, that data from the user, and then we capture it, we process it, then it becomes part of our program. Maybe something the user typed on a keyboard and mouse, or maybe through the app, or etc. Whether it's a graphical user interface or a human-robot interaction kind of platform, we always get information from a user, and then that information is then processed, as we discussed before. Next, it could be data read from a file. So it could be a file that we have stored somewhere, and that file contains a thousand of data points that we're going to use. This is something sometimes we use in data science or, example, machine learning, that we have sources of data coming to us from files or from databases. Of course, another way of saying data file is a database where the information is saved in a structured set of data. Library, another source of data is a library, which is sometimes when you include a library into your program, and we'll talk about libraries in details later, but for now you can say a library is a like your friend's program or a program written by somebody else, and you don't want to repeat their work. So instead of just writing their whole work all over again, you just include their program into your program. So whatever information that they had defined or used, then it becomes available to you as well. So that's what I meant by data defined as part of the library. Okay, what else? Well, now you have sometimes data coming from hardware. Like if you are dealing with an electromechanical system or an interface, then you have some data captured by sensors. You know, if you have a heat sensor, a light sensor, or a microphone. Microphone essentially is an audio sensor. It captures voice and then transfers that voice. I'm not sure if that definition actually holds, but let's just ignore that for a minute. So let's just focus on sensors in general that captures data, and then that information is then introduced to the program as well. And finally, this could be a remote part of a remote data. What does that mean? This is something that could be related to some of these earlier sources, but the difference is that this information, let's not point only the data file, it could be any of the above, but the difference is that it's not exactly on the same machine or in the same area where your program is. For example, your program could be living in this computer, for example, right? But your sensor is somewhere here in another building or another. Let's say you are in one city and then your sensor is placed in the field, but then the data is traveling through the cloud, right? And then your computer or your program can talk to the cloud and receive that information. Well, if you understand this concept, then congratulations, you now understand IoT. That's how IoT actually works. It's all about transferring data through the cloud. And remote sources of data is basically under anything related to the IoT or any kind of cloud-based information. We could actually write some programs that would look through the internet through a certain source of data and then capture the data in real time. And by the way, we could also have the program send data to the other way as well. And that is definitely possible. So regardless of the type of data which is but the key element to it is that essentially it's a remote source of data. That makes it, could be, by the way, the remote source could very well be another program. It could be a user, but remotely placed somewhere else. It could be a data file, but on a remote computer. Could be a library, again, on a remote source. It could be a remote sensor. You know what I mean? But the point is that there is an extra protocol that is involved here, which is the remote operations that is actually involved in the data or the data arriving to your program. So we will deal with this. Which one of these or which of these we will be doing or dealing with in our course or in this course? Considering that this is essentially an introductory course for first timers, it's kind of overwhelming to cover all of these different sources at once. That could actually become a little bit overwhelming and distracting for beginners. So that is why in this course we will primarily cover, we will not cover all of these sources, or when I say cover, I mean actively really do. In this course, we will cover the following sources. We will cover libraries, definitely in program, which is user defined, and then we will also cover libraries. Another possibility that we could include, but it depends on our time, is data file. It's not really that magical, but we could. And sensors and remote are more or less related to a different course, which is electromechanical or controllers. But for the time being, we can say for sure that we're going to cover these three sources, which is user-defined and user input, as well as libraries. If we have time, we will deal with the data file. But other than that, these other two sources, sensors and remote sources, we will not be covering in this course, but we will be covering in my other course, which is electronics and microprocessors, or embedded systems and IoT. If you want to find that course out, you will actually see it in my channels, as I will leave a link to it in the description area. Okay, so let's move on. So now what's next? So now that you understand the purpose of the program and you would like to learn about programming, you want to begin coding, where do you go? Well, in the past, we could always write a program using Notepad. Believe it or not, we could have just simply started a Notepad and wrote a program right there. And then once we wrote that program, and then we'll have to go to the command line and then run that program there. And believe it or not, this is still valid today. However, writing programming or programming this way is extremely difficult, because even say that you have written a program this way, it will be difficult for you to do a lot of other things. You see, programming is not just writing. You would also want to do things like error checking. You would want to compile the program. You want to. So I went actually online and I copied a very simple program. So let's say I wrote this program, which is essentially the Hello World in C. I can actually copy and save this file into my desktop, and I can call it hello and then .cpp. This is a very valid program and it can run. I know, because it's completely valid. But then again, if I just did this now, and you would not see anything change. There is no warning, there is no reminder, there is nothing. And even if I save it, nothing is going to happen. You would need to know every single command in the language itself by heart. You have to memorize it in order to know where the mistakes was. And this is extremely difficult for beginners, and even for professionals for that matter. So that is why you would need the IDE, the Integrated Development Environment. Essentially, it's a software, something like Notepad, really, but it allows you, or creates to you, a comprehensive environment for software development. That includes program writing, editing, error checking, debugging, library installation and management, visualization and emulation tools, and plenty of more other features that you don't even know yet that are all available in IDE. Without the IDE, your programming life will be a complete nightmare. But with the IDE, it will be a little bit less headache, and because a lot of the features that are you have to do are simply automated. So this is a program that I wrote. And this, again, is regardless of what the program is, but this is essentially the program that I'm shaking right now, is an example of an IDE. This is Genie, my favorite IDE. It allows you to compile, build, and execute. And as you can see, the code is already color-coded. And if I change something, you can see that the color has changed. Indicates that this is no longer the namespace keyword. So that's why right there and then I realized there are other IDEs that even after you make this change, it will give you a message right there and then telling you that this is an error, and then gives you some suggestions. Of course, you might have, some people might prefer other IDEs, by all means. I prefer Genie for a number of reasons, which I will go through later at later points. But for now, Genie is perfect for me. It's very lightweight. Other IDEs maybe have other features, but then they are quite heavy to install and work with. So that's why I prefer something very lightweight. And especially for beginners, Genie is a good idea. We will come and see Genie. We will come and see Genie again when we do the hands-on. But for now, let's continue with our introduction. Now, some IDEs have specific, some IDEs are specific for their languages, like MATLAB. MATLAB is not just a language; it comes built in with its own IDE. Arduino comes with it with its own IDE, some other IDEs are built for in general for general purpose, like for any language you like, such as Genie, Notepad++, and other IDEs as well. Now, if this is something that you would like to explore more, you can always go online and search for, you can really Google the expression best IDE and then your favorite language. So for example, if you go to Google and try best IDE, now the best IDE is very general term, but as you can see here, you can always just write best IDE and then you can specify your purpose. For C++, for Python, but then of course, don't straight away choose that. You might want to read some more about it, and maybe you want to even try some features. So there you can see a lot of articles that discuss the best features or the best IDEs for any particular language. So this article right here discusses the best IDEs for C++. Let's see if Genie is on the list. I don't think so. Okay, this is the criteria. So they have Visual Studio. Yeah. Not interested. Visual Studio, CodeBlock, CLion, Eclipse, and CodeLite. Nope, Genie is not on the list. Well, I don't care. Well, all of these IDEs are great to use, but I know maybe that you could come to these when you are more advanced into the language, when you have completed few, when you are more comfortable with the language. But if you'd like to go for any of these IDEs, by all means. So again, it's not like I don't like Visual Studio. Visual Studio is actually great. I worked with it in Java as well as for Android. It's just that it's too heavy to install and too heavy to work with. And that's why I prefer something very lightweight like Genie. Again, Eclipse, CodeBlocks. I work with Eclipse. If you have done any Android coding, then you have definitely have seen Visual as well as Eclipse before. NetBeans, no, Dev, C++, I've worked on it once, but not much, and yeah, so again, I don't see Genie on the list. Well, I don't care which list is this, I'm more than happy with my, with Genie, and this will be the one that I'm going to be using in my course in the following videos. Now, the reason why I'm using Genie is because, eventually, I work a lot with Raspberry Pi, and BeagleBone systems, and you know, it's weird when you're doing a video and then a sneeze comes along. It's like you're not sneezing, but it's not going away either. It's like somewhere in between. So let me deal with it. Okay, sorry. So Genie comes built in with Raspberry Pi, as well as also can be available with the BeagleBone. So that is why, although I can install other IDEs there, but because it comes built in with the Raspberry Pi, then it's a good idea to be familiar with it at least. Now, it really doesn't really matter which IDE you work with. If you understand the language and you know how to write the code, really it doesn't matter which IDE you work with. It's like cooking food and then utensils. If you know how to cook, if you know the recipe, it doesn't matter what utensils to use, because there's the quality of the result or the flavor. It doesn't really depend on the utensils. It depends on your skill, and of course it depends on the ingredient. So the utensil, think of the IDE as the utensils or the tools that you use to create your code. But then again, your skills as a writer or the coder, plus the ingredients or which libraries to use, these are your skills. It doesn't really matter which IDE to use. So once again, my primary reason why I'm using Genie is because it's very lightweight, very simple to install and download and use. The others are great, but they have their own purposes, their own reasons, which we do not cover in this course. So let's move on. Okay, so this is the last topic, I think. Let me go back and check out the beginning of this list. Yeah, so we've already covered applications. We've talked about working with data. We talked about sources of data. We talked about emerging technologies as well as the IDE. And the final topic is just to get to know these languages: C++, Python, MATLAB, and Simulink. This is not any, we're not going to do any coding. It's just sort of meeting a person for the very first time. It's like saying hello to this thing called C++. Of course, if you are already familiar or you have done some coding before, it's fine. Think of this as a sort of get to know people again. So C++ is what is called a general purpose compiled language. Compiled? Well, if that doesn't make any sense now, this will be explained in a minute. Now, it was first developed as an enhancement of an earlier language, which is the C language. By the way, the C language is also still around, of course, and just as popular as C++, if not more. In fact, let's talk about popularity. See, the C++ language is the fifth language overall in use today. And last year, it was the fourth. You want to see which one was number one? It was C. So, it's Python. Number two is C. And so why are we learning C++ and not C? Well, C++ has a lot of reasons. By the way, this is a very long debate that I don't want to go through right now, which is better. But the short answer is that C++ and C are essentially from the same family. They even use the same compiler. And if you are good in one language, you will be good in the other. So while we are learning C++ this course and we are focusing on it, you can consider yourself also proficient in C. In fact, some of the language in C++ are borrowing from C directly. So think of this course as indirectly learning C as well. And if somebody who is pro-C or, you know, supporter of the C language, and he feels offended by this statement, I apologize in advance. Now, we are just talking to beginners here and not professionals. Of course, there are differences, but for the time being, we will focus primarily in this course on C++. Okay, so C++ executable, which is the program that you create in C++, is cross-platform. It can be run or it can run on any operating system. C++ has a rich support libraries available online and written in C++, extensive community, online learning material in C++, you name it. It's very much out there, and it's very much available out there for you to learn more. Now, one of the biggest features about C++ is speed. And what I mean by speed is that when a program runs, it takes few seconds to execute. And if the program is really complicated, it could take even longer. Now, if you're running a system that or a program that could involve, say, a calculator, let's say you just keyed in some numbers and you're just waiting for the result, you wouldn't mind waiting for a few seconds to get the result. But if you are running a program, or if your program is controlling a car or a rocket or or an airplane or anything that is really, really critical, then you cannot afford any kind of delay. You want to make sure that the program is very much responsive and you want it to run as fast as possible without any delay, even if it's milliseconds. Sometimes these milliseconds can make the difference. So that is why it's very important that sometimes for us to run the program as fast as possible. Now, C++, when compared to other languages, it lacks certain features. Like let's just call these features automated features or built-in features. These features are not present in C++. They are present in other languages, such as Python, for example. Inclusive garbage collection and automation, etc. While these features make these other languages appealing, and definitely they do, it also makes them slower relative to C++. Because C++ does not have these features, it makes C++ running, or it makes the execution speed quite fast, and that could make the difference between C++ and other languages. So when you write an interface program, a hardware interface program between C++ and Python, especially if it involves complex operations, you would find eventually that C++ is the faster to execute. That's why C++ is very popular for hardware interfacing, as we mentioned earlier. It's because of the speed that is involved. All right? Now let's talk about C++ a little bit more. C++ was originally created in the late 70s, but that was only back then it was considered still as an extension of C. And it wasn't until 1998 where it was considered a language on its own, a standard language on its own. I don't want to go through depth into why C is still around, but I'm going to try again to be kind to both sides. Another comparison that you might be familiar with is the metric system and the imperial system. The metric system came a little bit later, and it's more recent. You can call it like 70 years old. Basically, it was introduced in the 50s or in the 40s of the last century. But the imperial system, you know, pounds feet and all that stuff, was around for centuries before. So worldwide, you still you can see that the metric system has been adapted, but then the imperial system, the pound feet, is still being used in the U.S. So why is it still being used? Well, because of tradition, because of it's already established in the industry, it's difficult to restart all over again, and so on and so forth. So it's the same thing for C versus C++. Yes, C++ have features that could make it a little bit superior than C, but C has already been established back then and by then, so it's kind of difficult to sort of undo all of the coding in C and then do it again in C++. So that's why, and then instead of sort of closing and then switching to C++, C itself was enhanced. So that's why they both still exist today. But we're not going to go into that debate again. So starting from 1998, C++ was considered a language or was basically was declared a language on its own kind of thing. Then in 2003, this was the second edition of C++ was adopted or updated. And then comes the 2011 update, which is the version we're going to use in this course today. There are other versions that came after that. We have the C++ 14, C++ 17, and the more recent C++ 20. However, as you can see, the version we're going to be using in this code is the C++ 11. And reason for that is because this will be explained in the next slide. But for now, just pay attention that this will be the version we will be using in this course. The difference, if you would like to read more about it, you can just click on this link and then you can actually read more about it. So let's just go ahead and give it a try. Does this link work? Let me shut down. Yeah, so it does work. So you can click on the link and you can read more about the history of C++ and also the different versions of it and what is the pros and cons about using C++. I'm not going to go into that. You can read this article on your own. So now, what's next? So now let's talk about how the C++ language actually is executed. When you write a program in C++, if you take a look at the code that I created, that I copied elsewhere, or even this code right here, it doesn't matter what this code is all about. I just want you to pay attention to a few things. If you read the word include, regardless of your, even if you have never written a programming program in your life before, you know what the English word include means, right? Main, for, what else? You will be familiar with these terms. You might not know what this F means, but you would know what stream is that right? So the same thing with math. Here's an example, by the way, of a C library that is included in C++. This is the math library from C. We are borrowing it from C library. So when you're writing a program, we always sometimes use keywords or commands that are understood by human language, right? Things like print, function, loop, f, while, and so on and so forth. However, the processor, when it runs your program, it does not really understand these human words. Instead, it only reads binary. So you would need something to translate this human words or high-level language into binary code. Actually, in reality, what happens is a little bit more elaborate. Your high-level language, which is written in C++ or Python, is first transferred into or converted into something more intermediate, and that itself is converted into the binary. But I'm not going to go into depth into that. But let's just say that for now, that this is what happens, and the thing that is involved in this conversion is the compiler. The compiler takes your program, does a bit of magic, and converts it into binary, which is understood by the processor. Without going into details into that process or explaining any further, if we do go deeper, that would be software engineering. I don't really want to go into that. But all we really care about for now is that the compiler's job is to convert or to write or to take your program and then recreate it in a version or in a version that is understood by the processor. So in C++, that would be the compiler. The compiler actually does this job, which is to translate your program into binary. That is why C++ is called the compiled language, because it uses a compiler. And just like we have many versions of C++, we also have many versions of the C++ compiler. Just to add more to the confusion kind of thing. I already received this question from one of the students, one of the beginners of learning this language, and he was already asking, he said, "I'm already confused. C++ uses compiler, so which ones are you talking about? C++ versions or C++ compilers versions, or what's going on here?" So I can understand the confusion, so I'm going to go through this one more time. There are different versions of C++, as you can see here. We're going to use this version for now, and I'm going to explain the reason in a minute. And C++, all of these C++s that you see in front of you, they use compilers. The compiler itself comes in different versions as well. So let's take a look at those. So again, if you read this article, if you click on this article and you check it out, what's going on here? Yeah, let's take a look at it. Excuse me. All right, so this is now an article that talks about the C++ compilers and the differences between them. I suggest that you come here and read more about it and then understand the differences between them. We're going to be using the number one compiler, which is the MingGW or the GCC compiler, which is right here. This compiler is referred to sometimes as the GCC compiler, is because it's the most widely used compiler for C++. It's not the only one, but it is. And the GCC comes from this, which is the GNU compiler collection. If I go further now, what is GNU? That's a long discussion, but for now, let's just call this. Now, why they call it a compiler collection is because it can compile a number of languages, includes C++, C, Fortran, and a bunch of other relatives. But this is the one that we're going to be using when we are actually programming in C++. All right, so let's take a look. Let's get back here. Now, why I use this one? Because it's the number one compiler and it's the most widely used. Now, as of 2021, this year, the default C++ version that is supported by the GCC compiler is C++ 11. What does that mean, the default version? It means every feature in the API, every feature in the C++ definition, right, is completely supported by the GCC compiler. So that is why this is the language, or this is the version that we're going to be using in this course. We'll get back to this. So what about these versions? What's going on here? Well, these are also supported, believe it or not, but not completely supported. They are partially supported. Some of the commands that are in the 14, in the C++ 14 definition are supported by the compiler. Some of the 17 commands are supported by the compiler, but not all the features and not all the definitions of the language are supported. Furthermore, when you download and install the compiler, by default, it will be set to compile here. If you would like it to compile 14, 17, or even 20, you will have to I'm not sure if it's supporting 20 or not, because this just came out literally weeks or months ago. But I know there is support 17 and 14. So if you'd like to actually write, if you'd like to compile it to compile commands from these definitions, you will have to reconfigure your compiler in order for it to support these languages. And this is something that we were not going to do. I know that this is some sort of regression, that why are we working on an earlier language where the new features are there? This is all cool, but at least for beginners, those who are still learning the language, it's a good idea to learn to stick with a language that does not involve compiler changes. Now, the reason why for that is because why I want you to stick with 2011, because this is the same compiler that we all gonna have, the one that you're gonna install, the one that I'm gonna install. There's no changes involved anywhere. It's the standard installation. If you're gonna configure your compiler to support 17 and 14, then I'll have to do the same thing. But then what if others didn't do the same thing? So this will create different versions of compilers in different computers. Your machine will have a different compiler setting than mine, and so on and so forth. And as a result, we're not gonna have a consistent environment between you and me. So when you are submitting your programming assignments and I would like to evaluate your work, then I don't even know what settings you have used. So that is why in order for all of us to standardize our installation and to work with a language that is also standard, we're gonna work with C++ 11 for now. Unless it's on purpose that we want to go for 17, but for now, or 14, but for now we will stick with 11 for now. So consider this as a notification that if you are working on the lab sheet in C++, then we're gonna have to stick with C++ 11 for now. Until, of course, we hear the news that C++ 17 or 14 were completely supported, then in this case, we will switch to it accordingly. But for now, we will stick with 11 because it's a fully supported version of C++. So that covers our coverage for C++. So now let's move over to Python. Now, Python is a different language, obviously, but it's called an interpreted language. And you will see in a minute why that's the case. Now, Python is designed specifically for readability and built-in features, as you can see here. Those built-in features are supporting memory management as well as automation. Specifically, it's very popular. As of 2021, Python is the number one language used in the world. It was second last year, but essentially it's number one this year. What else? The next feature, of course, it's again support. So it's again cross-platform. I think this is sort of a standard for every language now. So next is rich support as well, libraries, community, and online learning material. That's also supported. And finally, the feature that is key feature about Python, that is automation. It's often described, or the language is often described as batteries included. That means it comes built in with a lot of features that you don't even have to worry about, such as you don't need even a compiler. You don't even have to compile. That's one of the features already. Built-in garbage collection and dynamic coding, as well as automation. Now, in order, maybe right now when you're reading this, you will not fully appreciate these features. You will only appreciate or recognize the value of these features once you do programming yourself. So that's why, even if you do not fully appreciate this value or recognize these values right now or these features, don't worry. Later on, or after we finish coding, or after we do the coding together, I suggest you come back here to these slides, and then these slides will make perfect sense to you. Okay. What about features? What about versions of different? What about different versions of Python? Well, since its inception, since it came out in the early 90s or in the mid 90s, there were actually three different versions of Python. Python 1, which is not very obsolete, we never worked with it, is the first one. And Python 2 came out in the year 2000, And then Python 3 was released in 2008, fully ratified 2018. Check this out, yeah. Python 3 came out in 2008, fully ratified 2018. That means 10 years later. It took 10 years for the language to be fully ratified and fully supported. Hopefully this explains or give you an idea as to why these languages or these features of C++, while they just came out, they are more or less very recent. 2014, 2017, and they are more or less recent. And this guy just came out last year. You get me? So I'm not even sure if it came out last year or this year. So it's kind of very, very recent. So that's why a programming language being released, or a definition for a programming language is released, does not necessarily mean that it's going to be automatically adopted. It takes time for the industry, for the community to really fully adopt it or becomes fully ratified. There are many reasons for that. The compilers or the, you know, the supporting technologies, the third-party libraries, the community itself, proficiency in that definition, they'll need time to learn it, and as well as the presence of material and training material in that language. So that's why it takes time for a language to become fully ratified. In fact, up until a few years ago, I was still working on both Python 2 and Python 3. And in fact, you could install Python 2 and Python 3 side by side into your computer. And you could run programs side by side with Python 2 and Python 3. I'm not sure if this was possible. I think this was also possible in C, because you can configure the compiler to tell it to run C++11 or C++14. Now, the difference is in Python is that you don't have to configure anything. You can just install Python 2 and Python 3, and then when you run the program, you have to simply tell the system which Python you want. This was still around until very recently, and in fact, technically speaking, you can still do it today, because Python 2 today is available, you can find it online, but it's not supported anymore. It's no longer supported. You really need to make the switch. Now, if you really need to learn more about this and why the change and whether or not should you still learn Python 2, I suggest that you come and take a look at this article. This is a very nice article about Python 2 versus Python 3 and which should I learn. And this was written in 2018 when Python 3 was fully ratified. And then basically you should read more about it. First of all, why they change it, what are the differences, and then what should you do? Should you learn 2 or 3 or both? Now, if you already learn any of them, but if you learn, let's say, Python 2, then adapting to Python 3 is very simple, the similarly the other way around. If you're learning Python 3 and you want to know the differences in Python 2, then it's also similarly easy for you. It's going to be only difficult for you if you have already written some code in Python 2 and you want to upgrade it. That will be difficult. But if you are developing a new program altogether, then I suggest that you switch to Python 3 directly. But still is important for you to learn at least or understand the difference between Python 2 and Python 3, because sometimes when you go online, you might find solutions or training material or even videos or whatever are still written in Python 2. In fact, even my very own videos, just like the one you're watching now, if you go to my channel and you can actually see my list, my programming list, where is that code? Yeah. This is my other course that I was talking about earlier about, you know, controllers and programming. Now, actually, in this program, in this list, let's take a look at the list properly, right? So if you take a look at this list, and you would see that right here. So you see this video right here, I talk specifically about the differences between Python 2 and Python 3. It's because when I actually created the earlier video, which is the introduction, although Python 3 was already out there, I still used Python 2. I don't know, call it legacy, because when I learned Python for the first time, I learned it in Python 2. So when I created this video, it was in Python 2. But then I made this video from this point onward, it was actually in 3, and I made some other changes to go accordingly. And all of the videos that we're going to be making in this course will be Python 3. And later on, when we do hands-on coding together, it will also be in Python 3. So that's why it's a good idea to, it's a good thing. Come to think of it, I realized something that you can actually use my videos as a good source to compare between Python 2 and Python 3. You see, this video on my previous course is still in Python 2, but later on when I create the same video, which is Introduction to Python, it will be in Python 3. So you can actually compare these two videos together. So that would be a good idea or a good thing to go and do. Okay, so that was about the different versions of Python. What about the Python interpreter? And similarly to the compiler in C++, the purpose is exactly the same. Once again, you're writing code in human language. In fact, it's more human in Python. We're using a lot more human code or human words compared to C++. A lot of the commands or operators, we could use the human words rather than symbols. But then the process after that is the same. That has still need to be translated into a binary eventually. But in Python, we don't use a compiler because this language is already interpreted. We use what is called an interpreter. But unlike C++, we don't download or use an interpreter separately. We don't click on interpret, then run. No, we don't do that. Instead, when we install Python, when you download Python and use it, it comes built in already within Python. So when you actually write a program in Python, all you really have to do is just hit run, save and run. You don't have to compile and build because it's already pre-built for you. There was one more slide. It looks like I did not include it in these slides. So let's take a, let me get it from the other one. Just 1 second. There's one slide that is missing from here, but it's in my other presentation. Let me just go and get it. I'm looking at my other screen. Slides. Yes, I found my other slides in my, I found the slides in my other presentation, an earlier version of this. So let's take a look at it. So this is the slide that I was missing, which is, okay, now that we have discussed Python and C++, let's summarize the differences between Python and C++. Now I understand that some of these concepts that you're reading in the table right now will not make any perfect sense or any sense for you at all, because we have not done any coding. So if you are a first-time beginner to the language, you would not even understand what this is. What is a variable declaration? What is a variable for that matter? What's a variable scope? So these concepts will sound very foreign to you right now. That's why you can, don't worry about these definitions for now. Don't panic. I'm just putting it out there. You just take note of it. Now, later on, after we have done programming with Python and after we have done programming with C++, that's 10 weeks in total. After you have finished all of these hands-on session together, then you can come back here to this slide, which is going to be available in your PDF slides, and then read this table again. Then it will make perfect sense, because you by that time you would had already enough time to declare variables, to work with functions. And then you would understand the meaning of variable declaration, function declaration, as well as variable scope. However, you would at least understand for today, you would understand these guys, which is garbage collection and syntax. In garbage collection, Python is built in, or you can say that garbage collection already comes in built in. C++ is not built in, then you'll have to do it, or you'll have to write code for that. If you want to ensure, or if you want to achieve garbage collection or memory management, you'll have to write separate code just for that. The syntax is the grammar rule of the programming language. So you can say that a programming language, we will cover syntax in a while and in a later point. But for now, you can say that the syntax is the grammar rule of the language. And in Python, it's much easier to write code, but in syntax, C++ is a little bit more complex. When I say more, I mean relative to Python, okay? If you, once again, the rest of the table, if you do not understand fully, it's fine, don't panic. We will essentially discuss that again once we finish the programming code later on. All right, what's next? So now go back to our original slide that we have here. Oh yeah, the couple of introductions essentially is, or the last introduction we're gonna talk about is MATLAB. So MATLAB is another very popular programming language that is very high in demand really for engineering applications. That is why as an engineering graduate, regardless of the field, civil, mechanical, or even anything else, E&Es, or even software for that matter, of course, you must be very comfortable writing programming code in, or you're writing code in MATLAB. However, MATLAB is slightly different in Python and C++ in many ways. So number one, Python is not free. Python is what they call a proprietary language. What does that mean? Means it, if you want to use MATLAB, you have to pay for a license. C++ and Python are open source. They are open to anyone out there to use. In fact, anyone can not only use but also contribute to C++ and Python. But MATLAB is a proprietary language. It's owned by an organization, and if you want to use it, you have to pay for a license. I think there is an equivalent to MATLAB. I forgot the name of that language. It's very similar to MATLAB, but it's for free. Let's call it, always can Google MATLAB alternative or whatever language, MATLAB alternative. And I think there are actually a few, Octave. Yeah, that's the language I was trying to remember. There are a bunch of others that are actually alternative to MATLAB, but then the one that I was trying to remember is Octave. Because Octave and MATLAB are extremely similar, but Octave is free. Similar, yes, but not all features of MATLAB are available in Octave. For example, MATLAB supports Simulink, the Octave doesn't, to my knowledge. If it does, then please excuse me. Now, MATLAB is not just a language. MATLAB is a language plus the IDE all built in together. When you download MATLAB, after you have paid for the license, you also are installing its IDE. So when you run the program, you also run the IDE together. You open up the, it's, if, imagine it like your the language is, MATLAB is like C++ combined with Genie all together. That's the package. So when you buy the license, you get an IDE like this. Of course, it's more elaborate than Genie, but then it's designed for one purpose, to support MATLAB. But MATLAB also supports an extension or visual toolbox extensions. These are designed to enhance the features of MATLAB even further by supporting visual lectures, visual content or visual tools, one of which is famously, of course, known as Simulink. So Simulink essentially is an extension, is a visual extension of MATLAB. So that's why when you want to learn Simulink for the first time, you will notice that it might not be required, but it will be definitely a requirement, I know that's contradictory. When you work with Simulink, you're not really writing MATLAB code, but it could definitely happen. You could write a programming code that generates data, and then that data could be visualized or processed further using Simulink. Speaking of Simulink, now Simulink itself is it's not a language. It's not a programming language. It's not a language at all. You don't really write code. What you do really is that you create a tool. I know it's kind of difficult to visualize with that an example. So let me try and find something from the web. So Simulink. Let's just type Simulink and see what we get. So if I'm doing this on my other monitor. I'm going to move it over here. Okay, that's fantastic. So see, when you type Simulink and you look for the images, you will see these things. Now, this is what I meant by a visual toolbox. You are not really writing code with text. You're just using blocks here that will perform some form of work. So what happened right now is that, for example, in this particular image here, you say you have an input information coming. We've seen that before, right? Input information, and then that information is processed here, and then that information is then sent output and then presented to the output, or it actually be sent to activate or actuate something. If this sounds familiar, then that's exactly what any programming language or any program does. It receives input, process, and then output. That's exactly what happens here. Now, and the purpose of Simulink is to simulate, hence the name, a process or an electromechanical system, an electrical system. And then we would like to, rather than build the actual system in the lab or in your on your desk, you build a simulation of it, and then you can then optimize it. Sometimes when we have an electromechanical system that involve a number of different machines, it will be a very difficult process to optimize. Which ones to change, which ones to update, which ones to improve. It's going to be very, very difficult to do so with a physical system. So what you can do is to, something like this, is to create a simulation of that system. And then you can play around with the simulated system rather than with the actual real system. You create a model of it, and then you can actually work with it and then simulate it. This is the real purpose of Simulink, and we will get to that at a later point. Now, when I say get to that, we cannot cover all of these languages in a single course. It's just not fair. So that is why, by the way, we have done for the content for this video, but I just want to go back and recap. So what I said earlier, that we're going to be talking about programming languages, the primary focus will be to C++ and Python. This is really the primary purpose of this course. We're going to spend 5 weeks on C++ and 5 weeks on Python, and that will be the focus of these two languages. MATLAB and Simulink, we will be doing something much, much smaller, just sort of an introduction only. You are expected to learn or to be introduced to these languages, MATLAB and Simulink, again in future courses. So think of this as just an intro only, few hours session only, and then after that we'll move you on. But the primary focus of this course, the hands-on part, will be in these two languages. So that concludes the fundamentals section of this video. Now we have one more theoretical video, which is essential terminologies and skills. That will be in my next video, so I'll see you there. Thank you very much for watching, and all the best in your studies. Take care.